Journey with Judy.
Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
Good morning. Thanks for choosing to journey with Judy this morning. I'm trying not to cry. Of course, I was crying in preparation for the last 10 minutes, but I'm not going to make this a crying show. However, this past week I have been so... I'm falling apart, aren't I, Dave? No, I'm not. No, I'm so not. Okay. This past week I have never been more convinced of the fact that I so am not in the spirit of Christmas. And there's a part of me that is embarrassed about that. I'm supposed to be your host of a spiritual and motivational show on Sunday mornings. And the reality is I'm so not ready. This has probably been the worst Advent ever. Advent being a preparation for, a time to get ready for, that which has nothing to do with materialistic things. I didn't even put a tree up. Okay, Dave's like rolling his eyes and wanting to cancel the show. No, I put one up for my kids. My kids have a tree. I do not have a tree. One of the biggest things that I love to do is decorate my tree. I have all these really beautiful ornaments, and I love it. And for whatever reason, I just wasn't into it. I just didn't feel like it. So I didn't put it up. Bob says he's still going to put it up with Campbell when I'm not looking. And here's the other thing I didn't even do. I didn't even send out a Christmas card. For 10 years, I've been sending out a Christmas card. And one of the greatest joys of this time of the year for me is always to get Christmas cards with pictures. I love them. And my kids love, Campbell especially loves, to sit down and match up your last year's Christmas card to your this year's and how you have changed. And she did that the other day, and it was really awesome. I think this disposition of not being ready for has everything to do with so many expectations of gift giving, of family commitments, of all the things that we're supposed to be, ought to be, and sometimes just totally don't even want to be, and even worse, sometimes we can't be doing. And of course, it permeates down to my kids as well, because all I want is blank. All I want is the continual theme. And see, at Christmas, it just seems like it's so much more justifiable to ask for it, doesn't it, Dave? It's like this is the time that I get to ask for what I want and I get to expect to get it. And I really believe that if I get it, it's going to be the end all be all. See, my son Channy had huge aspirations to snowboard the whole month of December. 23 days later, he is without what he wanted. Campbell was in a cheer competition, and they didn't perfect their routine to give them the first place prize, so they got second place. So she is, too, without what she wanted. Now she's willing to just take an iPad and a case, she said. Carter has not received his acceptance letters or football offers that he so wanted. So he, too, is without what he wanted. And now I think all he wants is just parents who aren't like Bob and I. Kennedy was told that the only thing that she wanted, she just couldn't have, and that would be the phone. I talked about that a couple weeks ago. She just can't have what she wants. So she is without all she wanted. Now all she wants is to not have a concussion so she can play volleyball again. That was one of this week's episodes as well. So this whole theme of like, all I want is blank, and we just keep filling in the blank. And we just keep changing what it is that we think that we want. So I can tell you 2 days before Christmas, the biggest party ever. I'm so not ready. I'm not ready for Christmas. I'm not ready for Jesus. And I know it all stems from the foundation that says, all I want is blank. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1, and we will be back.
Wake up, wake my yesterday, 'cause I'm
Okay, so I'm so grateful that it is a new morning and it is a good morning because this has been the worst Advent Christmas season ever. And I know my man's thinking that today might be a better day because I have fought with him more in the last month than I have in probably 5 years. And it's not even a fight because obviously I can talk and people can tune me out and that's what he does. And he really knows the issue is you. That's what he says. The issue is you. Because I have sucked the life right out of the Christmas season. The love, the joy, and the hope and peace that should be the permeating theme has just not been present. And I will take full ownership of that. And I'm guessing that my kids will blame me and I'll have to own that. So here we are 2 days from the most important party we could ever want to be part of. Ever. And see, this invitation is like others that you may have received where it says on the bottom, your presence is the present. First of all, I never believed that. I think that's bogus, Dave. Because really, is it? I mean, do people really think that? Or do they just think that it's the Emily Post, you know, etiquette thing to say? You know, if it's like your fourth marriage, your 10th child, your retirement from a job that you, I don't know, after 2 years. I don't know. Anyway, this party, this invitation is not like those. I'm here to tell you. It's so different because it's true. And see, when it comes to parties and gifts and giving, I got to be honest, I love to get gifts way more than I love to give gifts. I like to give them too, but clearly I like to get them more. As a matter of fact, for the first Christmas that Bob and I ever had together, I opened up every single Christmas present because I saw him in the closet before, and it was one of the things, I just told Campbell this, my daughter, it was one of the things that I had to confess before we actually walked down the aisle because I felt like it was a total betrayal, and I had to just say, dude, I can't tell you everything about my past, but I can tell you this thing that I did while we were together, and it was, I ruined my Christmas, and that's what I did, I ruined it, because there was no surprises, and see, the other three-thirds of my life consisted of me telling Bob. The first third, I would tell Bob how many gifts I got for him. Like, I would say, I got you 22 things, and he had three at the time. And so he would be back out at the mall and trying to measure up. Because you knew if, you know, don't you feel that way? Because you give based on what you're getting, and that's so not the way it's supposed to be, but that's always who I am, someone who gives with condition and expectation. And so I did that for the first third part of my marriage. And let's be honest, that didn't make me happy. No matter how many gifts I got, believing that more is better, I realized it wasn't. Because the second third, I never wanted any presents. I just wanted to be in a sanctified union. I would just say to Bob, I don't want your presents. I just want you to be nice to me. And of course, he would say, I am nice. It's you. It's you. The issue is you. But let's be honest then, too, it's so much easier to give a gift than it is to give what somebody really wants. And P.S., I really wanted both. I wanted to be nice and I wanted presents. So at that stage in my life, I realized that more isn't better and that more isn't even enough. And so here we are in the third of our life. And the truth is your presence is the present, is what I would say to Bob now. The desire to be here with me, loving, living, learning together, how to do this thing called life, is the best gift that you could ever give. And see, even though that's my reality check today, truly in the core of my soul, I know that the presence is the present. There's still an expectation and a condition that comes with that, isn't there, Dave? Because if you're not doing it the right way, because like Bob says, I'm not a mind reader. I never got the crystal ball when we got married. So just tell me what you want and I will give it to you. And P.S., he really can't. And then there's the whole kid thing. That just also emulates the expectation and condition. See, I'm about the wow factor. I was about it with Bob and I'm about it with my kids and I'm about it with you if you're in my life and you're getting a gift from me. But this year I'm really not giving because we're broke. But anyway, whole other issue. I would give my kids what they wanted and the thing that they would never think that they would get. And I hated when Santa delivered better than me. Like, I wanted to be the gift giver that blew them away. because I had expectations from them. I had expectations for them of the gifts I gave and how they were going to respond to them. And see, as a parent, I don't know about you, but I know I had to count things. I had to make sure, and Santa's so smart. Santa always knew how the dynamic of the family was. So Santa would know if your family could handle that one guy got six and one guy got four. But in my house, Santa knew that, like, we all had to have equal gifts because we'd always have lots of drama if somebody got more, had more things to open. And our tradition is you open one, I open one, they open, you know what I mean? And so if someone was left with 10 extra gifts, and obviously that would not fare well. But here's the other thing is I always loved, and I think Bob did too, to save the best gift for last. So they would get, and you know, you almost set them up to fail because, you know, my kids are so ungrateful. And P.S., they get that gene from their mother. Is when I didn't think I was going to get what I really wanted, just like them, it's like I was so bummed by the time I got to the last gift. And even though you're hoping against hope that it was coming through, like the package didn't look like that. Because I would always, you know, Dave, come on, am I talking about things that are totally true? Okay, good.
Yes.
Okay, good. So I'm not the only totally dysfunctional host of the show, but you are as well. Okay. So when, and then once they opened it, that was just this moment. It was just a moment of an indescribable joy that they had gotten what it is that they wanted, and that I had some small part in making that happen. And when I say I, it's always a we, Bob and I, of course. But see, it was just a moment of happiness. That was the sad part, because regardless of what time we got up, and we always established the night before what time we would get up as a family to do the Christmas thing, no one could go downstairs and see if Santa had come. And I cannot tell you how many times I wish he really left coal. Just to make a point that you have to be nice and not naughty, but anyway, whole nother thing again. But by 9 a.m., if we woke up at 8:30, we were back to whining and complaining. And I have to be honest one more time. It's like, I'm the kind of parent who, if you didn't give me the response I wanted or you didn't really make a big deal out of your gift, like for the next day or two, the minute the stores reopened, I returned everything. My kids would come looking for a Christmas present that I had returned and got a credit back on my credit card for. Is that rude? Mm-hmm. And then they would say, well, can I at least get something else? It's like, nope, I did not get the wow factor from you. So that's for there. I took the gift from you. That is the way I roll. So I guess the bottom line to all of it is, you know, what you thought you wanted is never what you really wanted. Almost ever. And every year I'm more convinced of that fact. See, because I want what they want. And you want what we want. And we all want what he wants. Ah, okay. You are listening to Journey with Judy. We got to go to break. Lake 96.1. And thank you to the Cunis Country Auto Group for sponsoring today's show. We'll be back.
I don't want a lot for Christmas. There is just one thing I need. I don't care about the presents underneath the Christmas tree. I just want you.
Okay, some of that song is totally true, which is why I'm crying. Because all I want is all you want. And it's all we're ever going to need. There's this other part of me that says, okay, but so I can't still have presents under the tree? Like, she sang that in the song. I disagree with Mariah. I want both. I want the presents under the tree, and all I want is you. Have you ever heard that expression, he's so hard to buy for? What do you give the person who has it all? See, Jesus is asking for the only thing he wants too. And all he wants for Christmas is you. See, it's the hardest thing to give, but the easiest thing to give. And really the only thing to give. See, giving our heart is always the hardest part. My brother gave me a computer. What's a screen? What's the thing you put your mouse on? Mouse pad. Yeah, duh, thank you. My brother gave me a mouse pad when I was in Florida. He found it at the store, and it said, Jesus loves you, but I'm his favorite. And he handed that to me and he said, this is totally for you. Because even in my walk of faith, I truly believe that I'm his favorite. I don't know why. I don't know how. But I just know I am. And see, you're his favorite too. And this thing about love where it says Jesus loves you. See, love is to desire the highest and best good for the sake of the beloved. And see, so the thing about Jesus is he only wants you to come to his party if you want to come. Because he wants you to want to. See, he's not like me with conditions and expectations. He's not about the expectations. He's about the expectancy. So see, with him, it's expectations, no. Expectancy, yes. And see, this love that he has, he won't only wait for 2 days. But this invitation that we were referring to, it doesn't even have a time that you have to respond by. Because he'll wait for however long it takes for you to want to. For you to want to realize that all you want is him. And all he wants is you. See, because our presence is really the present. This thing about God is he wants us to want to be with him even though he's already with us. The word Emmanuel, if you cut it in half, you dissect it, the I am part means accompanying, beside, and with. And the other part of it means God. So I'm a with you God. I'm a beside you God. Who needs to know that more than the people in Connecticut? See, because that community has been rocked in ways that we can't even put words to. Just days before Christmas, their expectations and all they thought they wanted have got to be entirely different today. And see, as selfish as I am, I've wanted to avoid the details of what took place there because I don't want to own the fact that I need to respond to it at the deepest part of my soul. To know that if that was me, because but for the grace of God, there go each and every one of us. How different we would be doing not only Christmas, but life in general. Because I'm guessing that the gift of presence, and not the gift kind, the gift of presence would be all every one of those people would be wanting for Christmas. The siblings, the family members, the relatives, the whoever, the community of people would just want nothing more than the presence of those people that maybe they took for granted, maybe they didn't. Maybe they valued, maybe they didn't. See, they have a privileged perspective of a with us God right now. They have a privileged perspective of not only recalling the first coming of God, but pondering the second coming of him, and then actually embracing the fact of what a blessing it is that he's here in this, beside them, with them. Because if he wasn't with them, how could they say the things they're saying? If he wasn't with them, how would people come from everywhere and get focused on something other than their own Christmas responsibilities and obligations because of what took place there? Your first responders didn't think twice about what time of the year it was, and it wasn't convenient to drop everything to go there. They just went. And so, see, these people get to see God in the face of other human beings. They get to actually be people of love, hope, joy, and peace, which is what this season is supposed to be about. In the midst of the most indescribable tragedy ever. And I can tell you that if it impacts us in a way that we do life different, that is where God is in it. Because what Satan wanted for evil, God makes for good. Because God works all things for his good and his glory for those who love him. And I want to be someone who loves him. I want to be someone who realizes that my presence is his present for his birthday. Because his presence is my present every day. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1, and we will wrap it up when we get back. Okay, so as we wrap it up today, thanks for choosing to journey with Judy. And my prayer for you this week is as the birthday party for Jesus, which is only 2 days away, that Emmanuel, the go with us God, is so profoundly with you that you are present to the gift of his presence. I'm guessing those affected by the Sandy Hook tragedy would much rather have the presence than the presence. I pray that you return the very gift you received, because his presence is your present. Because all he wants for Christmas is you. Have a blessed and holy Christmas. Life Matters is next with Dave and Nancy. This week, keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. Peace out.